Bismillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. My dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. This is your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. I recently posted some talks about some stigmas that are following us in Islam about the world of women. This pep talk is going to be the first in a series of pep talks that deal or that will deal with a variety of different topics about women that relate to women, their world, and what it is that they are enjoying as Muslims and what it is that they are not enjoying but is out there for them to enjoy but for whatever reason hasn't been given to them as it ought to be. But first, let me tell you why I chose the term. This series name is called Stigmas. And that is because a stigma is any mark of disgrace that is associated to an act, person, or some situation. And it truly, truly is. There is a lot of great disgrace out there that is attached to the Muslim women. So much so that Muslim women today are less happier than their counterpart in the rest of the world, either Christians, Jews, or anyone else. This series, my dear sisters and my brothers, if for you ladies, is going to show you who you truly are, what are your rights, what it is that is in Islam for you. And you can go and use it. If it's not used, use it. If the society and culture fights it, this is for your time. This is your time to stand on your own feet and start fighting back. Because you need to gain back what Allah has rightly given to you. Throughout time, my dear sisters, the issue about women has had a lot of events. A lot of discussions, a lot of movements, revolutions, conspiracies, and you can name it. There has been, and there is still, a long, long, long battle and struggle from women to get their rights recognized and for them to enjoy them. Some of these rights are correct, some of them are not, but the struggle goes on. And a lot of times, it makes you wonder, why is it that it is men who debates the world of women? Why is it that it is men who runs the world while women are just citizens who are invited to enjoy the world and enjoy the right? A very famous singer, his name is James Brown. He recorded a song back in 1966, and that is the years where the sexual revolution started, where a lot of things really got off the hands of the church. Perhaps some of you who have seen singers of rock and roll or some types of concerts, they always see people raising the right hand, and sometimes both hands or arms, when their index and the pinky are put up. They are put up and they're kind of like some sign of acknowledgement. That sign are the corns of a shaitan. Now, why did they do that? Because in the 60s, when rock and roll started coming up in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, it was a revolution anti-church, because the church at that time there had a strong grip over its followers. Sex was demonized. It was a demonic. It was something of demons. This is why back in time, between men and women, they used to make love, both of them dressed up in a long gown. There is a hole where the man's private part is, and there is a hole where the woman's private part is that. Sadly so, that understanding has been rubbed on us Muslims today, and there are scholars today that have called for that if a man and a woman sleep together or have sex together completely naked, divorce takes place. This is not some person out there. This is one of the great directors in one of the great universities of Al-Azhar in Egypt. So we do have some problems. Again, back to Mr. James Brown. What was the song that he made that became a status quo of chauvinistic movement in our time? The title is, It's a Man's, Man's, Man's World. It's, as I said, a very chauvinistic song, which became the status quo for men in this world. This song, written 51 years ago, we gave another boost to man that this world is in the hands of men. Women, you are entitled to it. The feminist movement here in the West started back in 1943. And this was when people started noticing the difference between men and women and how women were behaving and how they were treated and all that kind of stuff. So some women took it upon themselves to fight to gain the rights of women back. And then it died out for a few years and only got back into the mainstream back in 1968, when everything changed the world that we know today. The world prior to 68 was completely different than the world that it is today between us. The first thing that really affected women got back into the fight, or the feminism fight, back in 1968, as I said, that was in the month of May. And that happened when women started reading a book written by a French writer. Her name is Simone de Beauvoir. The title of the book, The Second Sex. The first sex being men, the second sex being women. And this book here was written by this lady here, who was a defender of women's rights. And it greatly influenced the feminist movement until today. Another current version was republished in 2009 to give a second boost to the feminist movement. Why do women need a movement to free them, to give them right? It's because men didn't give them right. This book here, The Second Sex, got translated into many different languages. First time in 1953 and then again republished in 2009. Strangely enough, my dear sisters and my brothers, Simone's writing explained why it was difficult for a woman, a talented woman, might I add, to become successful. Why women aren't earning as much as their male counterpart in the same job as they do. Women all over the world, my dear sisters and my brothers, are fighting to gain a better place in this male-dominated world. The fight is still going on, fierce and feisty. Women are very adamant at putting their demands forward to gain better recognition, better status, and a better life all around. Men in the West are being gradually educated, and men today are far more aware of women's problems than ever before. But in the Muslim world, that awareness is non-existent. Worse, it is fought back. Very rare so, in the name of Islam. I know, many men will say, look, hang on. Upon the coming of Islam, Islam has given women far more rights and better status than they ever had before. But my dear sisters and my brothers, my argument is not what Islam has or has not done for women in the past. My argument is how much of what Islam brought is being given to women today. And this is where my stigma series of pep talks come in. These pep talks, especially this very first one here, will clear a lot, and really a lot, and it will reveal to you a lot, because what's shown of what Islam has for women is unbelievably very, very less than what women truly deserve or are getting today. So, before much ado, let's get right with it. Pick up any book today that speaks about the right of women in Islam. And there is something that's going to strike you. It's either whatever is written or whatever is preached. There is a sentence they always start the talk with. Women before Islam were, and then they will tell you so many different things, and then they will say, but when Islam came, it did this to women. Dang, 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 dang. So what they really mean by that is that they want in your mind as a listener to create two eras. One era is when women were actually not women, but they were mistreated. Then Islam comes in, saves women from the calamities where they were in before, and here they are happily ever after living their lives today. But is this really what's happening? Let's first of all take a look at what they say when they say women were before Islam. As I was doing the research for this topic here, I found something that summarized pretty much everything that those women before Islam were would tell you. They would tell you the Greeks. The Greeks said that women were a poisoned tree, and also that women were an evil doing of Satan. And they will also claim that women were sold in the markets as any other merchandise. The Romans, on the other hand, they will always bring you the Council of Macon in France, where they debated if women had a soul or not. And for justice and fairness, this council didn't take place, and many historians have denied this fact. However, Muslims always keep bringing this as an evidence how Christianity had actually accused women for not having a soul, and that Islam gave her a complete, total, full, well-proved soul. They also said that the Romans said that pouring hot oil on a woman, it was the best form of punishment for her, and also that she should be pulled by horses till death. So this is what the Romans contributed to the world of women. The writers of the research that I was making even went and mentioned the Chinese. The Chinese said that women are bad waters which washes away happiness. The writer also said that the Chinese man had a right to bury his wife alive. If he dies, his family had the right to inherit his wife as they would inherit any other goods. The Hindus are also not spared in this analysis or this study. They said that nor death, nor hell, poison, or snakes are worse than a woman. So this is allegedly is what the Hindus think of a woman. And they also say a woman doesn't have the right to live. After the death of her husband, she must be burned with him alive. The Persians also were included in this research, and they totally allowed incest marriage. A relationship between any member of the family was permitted for them. A Persian can decide the death of his wife as he pleases. The Jews, our cousins, also said that women are a curse because she is the reason of disobedience. She is also an impure when menstruating. And they also say that it is permissible for her father to set her whenever he wanted to. As for the Christians here, in year 586, again, remember the Romans and Christians, they are close to each other. The French, as they say, held a conference to decide whether women had a soul or not. And as I said, that council of Macon in France did not take place. And for the fairness and justice of history, just like we don't like people when they lie on our behalf, we're not going to use that argument. But there are a lot of people out there that use this argument to tell people that Christianity and the church at one point didn't agree that women had a soul, but Islam did agree and gave a soul to women way ahead of its time. But in the English government here, where we are in England here, Henry VIII is claimed to have forbidden women from reading the Bible, the New Testament, because she was considered impure. And the Arabs, at the end, were very despiteful towards women, and they used to bury kids. If they don't bury the kids, it is always in wars and battles and fights that they are taken as slaves and everything. If they don't bury them, they throw them in wells and things like that. So as you can see here, women before Islam, they didn't have a life. They were sold, boiled, cooked, thrown in wells, buried alive. They don't have a soul. You can sell them. You're impure. They are evil. Look at the world today. How much of that has changed? I don't think much has changed. Still, the same beliefs are around. But is it really where you are, my sister, in the world of Islam? I have a question here that I'd like to ask everyone who speaks about women in Islam or the right of women in general, just to convince people that Islam is the right religion for them and that they should embrace Islam. Why, to establish women's status quo in Islam, do Muslim preachers always go to such belittling and belowing of women in other religions and cultures? Why do we put others very far low below just to bring Islam and the great of what Islam taught? Why can't we just preach Islam as Islam and let the listener make up their minds? Let's not control their thoughts before we preach what it is that we want to preach. The main reason is then to answer back with what Islam has brought to liberate women from the grips of oppression, injustice, and transgression, be that in the name of Islam or in the name of culture. The obvious answer to this question is pretty simple. Their aim is to put Islam's reforms high above anything else, and as such, use these reforms as positive rewards to push Islam to the broader audience for both men and women. And this is going to be around the world. And a new concept in this era of ours was conceived, and that is the right of women in Islam. Truth, my dear sisters and my brothers, be told. There is not a dedicated book that spoke about the right of women in the last 1400 years. They spoke about the rights of a woman as a married to her husband. So this is the right of wife and husband, but not as a woman, an individual, unmarried human. So what is the true status of women in Islam? Away from the hypocritical, dishonest, and pretentious claim of the false promoters. Because they put things down, and then they mention something normal in Islam, and it will sound to you, Ya Allah, Islam has really saved the world. Of course, if you hear someone telling you, do you know what? Christians used to debate that either women had a soul or not. But Islam has always said that women had a soul. What can you say in that for that statement? You go, Ya Allah, this is beautiful. I didn't know that. Well, in fact, it didn't happen. If we want people to embrace Islam, especially women, we have to be really transparent and very, very honest. Look at the whole picture of Islam. In the early years of Islam, especially in the first 13 years in Mecca, the call of Islam wasn't to defend or raise specifically the status of women, but to inject new beliefs that the Arabs didn't hold at that time. None of them was in particular to set women free or to put them in leadership position or. And that's because women were part of a society, a community. When Islam came, it spoke to both men and women as equals. It didn't come masked with a sword, liberate women, and then preach to them Islam. Just like Musa alayhi salam, when he was in Egypt, he had first to free the children of Israel from Pharaoh and then preach Judaism to them. Didn't happen like that at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. For example, Al-Islam indirectly gave us a preview in the lives of women in Mecca before the coming of Islam. For example, our mother Khadija, she was very rich. She was not oppressed. She was not put in a well and buried alive. Yes, some Arabs did bury alive, but that was not the norm. Some people did, like today. Rape happens, but it's not the norm. But we all hate rapes. And same thing was for burying the children or throwing them in a well. Our mother Khadija was a rich woman, and she had the choice over who to marry. Also, the wife of Abu Lahab, how she had a position in the community, and she used to fight Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she had to say. Hind, the wife of Abu Sufyan as well. So not all women at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Mecca were really, really poor and destitute, and the men really were on top of them. Not all of them. Women had a status. That's why when Islam came, it didn't bring much for these women. It brought something new, and I will explain it in my series of the stigmas, but it's not as the promoters of women before Islam were. As I said earlier on, one of the reasons why our scholars didn't write about the women and their rights is because there was no need whatsoever. Whatsoever. What Allah says in the Quran and what the Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says in the authentic hadith that work with the Quran hand in hand is for both men and women. Al-Islam didn't come here to say the man you should do, women should do. No, Allah speaks to the believers, and that includes us men and our sisters women. So as long as there are no specifics in the command, we all are in the same boat. Zakat is for men and women. Salat is for men. Fasting is for men and women, and so on and so forth. Everything is for men and women. But when there is a specific command that is for women, that is not for men, then Allah explicitly speaks like that. And He tells them, when you have menstruation, don't pray. And then for us men, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us certain duties that He doesn't want women to have, and then He would speak to us directly. That is why there was never a book called The Women's Rights in Islam written by any great scholars. It is, my dear sisters and my brothers, very unbelievable how many Muslims today do not understand what Allah tells them. They understand words, all right, but they can't make out of these words the purpose of what Allah wants from them. So many misunderstood and still misunderstand the style of conversation of how Al-Quran and the authentic ahadith that go hand in hand with the Quran talk to us. Women, as a consequence to that, are living hell, not because of the teachings of Islam, but because as Muslims, their lives are controlled and run and directed by dogmas and fatwa issued by the man of religion, not based on Islam, but by the grips of the culture. When Allah speaks in Al-Quran, in the whole Quran, my dear brothers and my sisters, unless and until explicitly directed to a group of people. For example, when Allah speaks to us, the believers who are Muslims and they pray and do all that kind of stuff, Allah speaks to us, ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, those who have believed. But when He doesn't use that, it is for all mankind. And when I say mankind, my dear brothers and my sisters, what do? I mean the English and French, the Vietnamese and Chinese, the Mexicans and Brazilians, South African and Gambian. I also mean Morocco and Egyptians, Danish and German, Catholic and Mormons, Jews and Buddhists, Australians and New Zealanders. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala today in this Quran that you have in between your hands, He speaks to all these people. It is not believable that as Allah talks to all mankind, we are going to reduce all mankind to a small group of a land that exists in the Middle East. This is unbelievable. We have got to read Al-Quran with international eyes, not through narrow, tight, and local Middle Eastern eyes. The problem that we're facing today is this. We want the world to first have the mentality of the Middle East and then read Quran, not read the Quran with the international mentality. This is why I find it really peculiar that when somebody embraces Islam, they become a Middle Eastern. I've seen English people that were sharp before. When they embraced Islam, they became dumb. They lose their own personality and become just like another person that has come from the Middle East parts of the world. Really peculiar. The problems that the Muslim women is facing today comes because, as I said, of the misunderstanding of the text of Al-Quran. And one of them is the ayah mentioned in Ali Imran, وَلَيْسَ الذَّكَرُ كَالْأُنْثَى, or in the nearest translation of the meaning, and the male is unlike the female. So they said, if the male is not like the female, this Allah is telling us that the male is better than the female. And why is that? Again, as I said, it's the misunderstanding. Wallahi al-Azim, this is what's getting us. Let me put this in a context so you understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to get out of this story. The whole story as told in Ali Imran is the wife of Imran, who one day was pregnant, and she said, Rabbi, in nadhartu laka ma fi batni muharran. Ya Allah, I have vowed that whatever is in my womb at this moment here will completely be dedicated to serving the temple in Jerusalem. So this is her intention. And she hoped for a baby boy. Because boys, when they grow, they are more muscular, they can defend, they can carry heavy rocks, they can clean, they can do a lot of jobs that a lady couldn't do or is not predisposed to doing. For example, cleaning the rubbish, the dirt, the poo, the pee, and all that kind of stuff. So the man can work harder than that. Then when the lady gave birth, she gave birth to Miriam, the mother of Jesus, son of Mary, alayhi salam. She was surprised and kind of like shocked. I had promised Allah a boy that I will dedicate to serve with the temple of Jerusalem. And here I have a girl. And a girl cannot be, when she's a teenager or whatever it is, be outside alone, stay late. You know what it is, the differences between the boy and the girl. Then, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when she said, وَلَيْسَ الذَّكَرُ كَالْكُنْثَى, i.e. the male is not like the female in service. She is apologetic to Allah. Ya Allah, in my intention and in my heart, I had big plans for this newborn baby. And since it is a baby girl, it's not going to be as big as I had initially wanted. This is the whole thing altogether. She was just making a statement. She didn't say that the boy is better than the female. She just said the boy, the male, is not like the female. And I wanted to pay attention here to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran. وَلَيْسَ ذَكَرُ كَالْأُنْثَى. Allah says, وَلَيْسَ, and he negated that the male is anything like the female. Allah didn't say, وَلَيْسَ الرَّجُلْ, another man is like the woman. He spoke about al-dhakar, the male, as gender. What this means is the shark, the male shark, will not behave and will not interact and will not be like the female shark. The male lion will not interact like the lioness. The male tiger, the tigress. The male butterfly, female butterfly. The male snake, female snake. The male buffalo, female buffalo. The male frogs, female frogs. And the list goes on. This is why when they study today, botanicals in any fields, they always, of the livings, they always study the male and the female, the male peacock, the female peacock, the male chicken, the female chicken, the male eagle, the female eagle, and they study them because they are not the same. You find some of them are different in behavior, some of them are more prettier than the other ones, some of the fish do something that the female doesn't do, and we are not, creation-wise, we're not the same. Emotionally, we are wired differently. It doesn't mean here that the male is better. It just means we are not the same. And this, everybody agrees to that. But when this has been misunderstood, guess what? That's why you, my sisters, are thought of less of a citizen of the earth than your counterpart, the male. The truth of the matter is this. It always shocks me to see the male gender in the Muslim world threatened by the female. Many male Muslims have difficulties understanding that the relationship between a man and a woman is not based on preference, but more so by what we are equipped with to deal with the life in general, with different situations in life, and in general, and specifically how to deal with each other, male versus female or female versus male. Allah in Al-Quran and in the authentic ahadith, which agree with Al-Quran, speaks about equipping each of the two genders with things that will make them better suited to carry certain duties that the other gender is not suitable to carry. It never was about status preference. It always was, is, and it will always be between the two genders about more suitability to perform in given situations. Therefore, the relationship of between men and women is more of a complementship, never was of preference. If it was about genders, who is the best, the male or the female, then let me put the best man that never ever farted in our time right now against, for example, our mother Aisha, perhaps the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Fatima, or maybe Hind, or Asma, or Sumayya, all these great companions that existed at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and see what status he would hold when compared to them. Can any male today claim he is far superior than these females? Can any male today, regardless of their status, wealth, knowledge, or whatever, claim to be higher and better than our mother Maryam, the mother of our prophet Jesus, alayhi salam? Can anyone claim that? If you cannot be better than a female that lived at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you are not better than any female that lives today or that will ever live. There is an ayah in Al-Quran, and I wish there was only one ayah, but there are many. But this particular ayah is really misunderstood by the male in general and also the female in general. And I find it really disturbing that I find myself defending women with Muslim men. And I don't find myself defending women with non-Muslim men. What this means is that there is a deep-rooted problem in the male gender's mind that they are superior and that women are stupid, are dumb, and they cannot run the world by themselves. And as such, we gotta treat them as ninth-class citizen people, just like little kids. But is this really true? Let me tell you what this ayah says. Allah says in the Quran, الرجال قوامون على النساء بما فضل الله بعضهم على بعض وبما أنفقوا من أموالهم. Piece by piece. الرجال قوامون على النساء. الرجال, the man, the male gender. They always translated wrongly, but I will give first my translation, then we'll tell you how they understand it. The men are vicegerent upon women. But in the regular translations, how people understand it is the men are in charge of women, just like you are in charge of your horse. There is a difference when you are in charge of your horse and vicegerent of the horse. When you are vicegerent, you make sure that he eats, he is safe, he is this, 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 but you have no control over it. The horse can go wherever they want, does whatever it wants to do. I'm sorry to have given this example, but to some dumb, stupid people, you need to give these types of explanations. So you, my sister, as a human being, I am your vicegerent. I am the one that's going to make sure there is a habitat where you live. Food is guaranteed. Clothing is guaranteed. Your safety is guaranteed. Your everything that is to make sure that you have a good life is guaranteed. This is why the female, in retrospect, likes a man who is confident, who is self-assured, who is assertive, who is an alpha male, a man who can defend her, a man who can give her a good progeny, because it is ingrained in our instinct. It's not something that makes me better than who you are or makes you less than better than who I am. It just makes us a compatible pair, just like a key and a lock. One key for one lock, and they are formed in a way that they serve the purpose of closing a door. So when Allah says, الرِّجَالُ قَوَّمُونَ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ, Allah gives the vicegerentship to the man, i.e. the man is the donkey that's got to work hard to ensure that the world of a woman is well taken care of. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, حَقُّ الْقَوَامَةِ, the right of this vicegerentship, is that بِمَا فَضَّلَ بَعْضَهُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ, by that which Allah has favored some of them, and that is men, upon the other, these are women. How did Allah favor me? He gave me muscles. He gave me a body that can endure outside. He gave me a mind that is not too sensitive, so that someone might tell me, I am fat. Look, go to a man and tell him you're fat. It doesn't hurt as much. But go to a woman and tell her you're fat, and you break her world. If I insult a man and a woman with the same insult, women will be very much hurt by that insult. There are certain things for our vicegerentship that are needed, and these things Allah gave them to us. Patience, we are enduring, we are fighters, we are killers. Killers are in the sense like to get bread, and as we do before, like if there is a bear or a lion or things like that, we are fighters. If I see a snake, I will not scream. A woman would scream because Allah has at that moment there in dealing with this snake, he has given me something that he hasn't given to a woman, and that is courage, that is patience, that is blah, 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 blah. And you can put the list behind that. So here is exactly what Allah means. بِمَا فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ بِهِ بَعْضَهُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ, by that which Allah has favored one above the others when doing their duties. وَبِمَا أَنْفَقُوا مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ, and one of the degrees that Allah has given the vicegerentship and favored us above women in this interactivity of marriage is because the man spends from his money. Even today, people, subhanAllah, the non-Muslim out there, when they have a friends or girlfriend or boyfriend, whatever, if a woman always pays the bills of a man, in the society we say it's taken advantage of you. when the man always pays the bills of his girlfriend or his wife or whatever that is, we can be like, oh, mashallah, he's a gallant husband. Oh, he's good. He's a keeper, you know. This man is not actually a miser. He spends on you. He's a good husband material. You see how the two communities look at the different giving things? So when Allah has given a man the ability to spend and make him a vicegerent, it's because women love that in a man. Let me tell you and ask you a question. How much would you love to spend on a man? Even the feminists, they say that I would love to be the one who spend on a man. And I told one of these feminists one day who said this to me, and I told her, excuse me, yes, it's a good thing that you spend your money on me. But I said to her, how much respect would you have for the man? And she looks at me surprised because we're in a group of people. And then she gets not much respect. And I said, that's exactly where it is. When a man spends on a woman, we do not look at it respect or not. We look at you as part of who we are. Just like I spend on myself. I don't even think about it. I don't disrespect you because I spend on you. This is the wrong understanding. And if a man understands this, then he has the wrong brain. Now that you know the meaning of this, the Muslim culture throughout history has had the very wrong understanding. In the past, this was not a problem because Muslims were speaking only Arabic and they were a superpower people, so it didn't matter much. But these days that we started translating our texts and people started actually paying attention to what we said, they started making us the laughing stock of the world. Because when a man understands that men are in charge of women by what Allah has given one over the other, and for what they spend with their wealth, they understand that men are in charge of women. They take control of their lives, they control them as they like, because they spend the money on them. It becomes like almost people who pay women, prostitutes, money so that they can do what they want with their bodies. Because you pay money, then you are entitled to full service, right? If someone has got this understanding, they really have a sick mind and worse, a sick heart. Another ayah in Al-Quran, which is also greatly misunderstood, is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلِلْرِجَالِ عَلَيْهِنَّ دَرَجَةً وَلِلْرِجَالِ عَلَيْهِنَّ دَرَجَةً and to the man over them a degree. Many, many took or look at this ayah as the ultimate authoritative statement from Allah for man to freely rule over and dominate women. This misunderstanding opened the door to a far more frontiers, there where women are really inferior, and that they are here on earth to subserve a higher being, man. This is again another sick and sickening thought and misunderstanding that is really poisoning our Muslim marriages today, and these are causing a lot of divorces, sadly. وَلِلْرِجَالِ عَلَيْهِنَّ دَرَجَةً. First thing first. When you look at this ayah, you find it mentioned in the middle within a very specific context, and that is divorce. This ayah is beautiful, absolutely beautiful. And before I go any further about it, let me reiterate that. Islam is a universal religion, not local. Islam is not for Saudi Arabia, and it's not for Baghdad, and it's not for Damascus. It's not for any one's place. It is a universal religion. It's the last one sent to mankind, and it is boundless, timeless, and free, applicable anywhere on earth, anyhow, anyone with anyone. You must, my dear brothers and my sisters, from now on, change your perception and look at Al-Islam as a universal religion. Look at it with the eyes of international, not with the eyes of local.